attitude, because that shapes things for many of you as you're thinking. Yeah, and sort of set the platform for what we're doing. And that's sort of the where I come out. I want to start with, wrong side. I want to start with schedule. Because of the mission teams, this doesn't exactly coincide, but what I want to do, what I did last Wednesday, what I want to do today, is just a little bit of an introduction to what we're about, what we're thinking about, and get some feedback from you. I'm going to ask for that, what you'd like to make sure we cover. Give a little time to share that. Then the next 2 weeks, John and Denise are going to talk a little bit more about traditions, customs, as well as funeral planning. That is not the service. I'm going to get into that with you. But the other arrangements, which are many, and a lot of things in a short period of time. So they're going to share some of that with you. I'm going to miss Wednesday, but I'll look forward to it. I think it's interesting what different people, families, and I want to say tribes, countries, cultures, how they handle it differently. Then, here we're always Wednesday first, then Sunday, and that takes us until we get into October and we have mission teams. So mission teams Sunday, we're not going to do the Sunday class, we'll just do mission teams. But the Wednesday we'll get a little bit ahead of that. So if you're planning back and forth, please make aware of that. So I put the dates up here, 2 and 13. We'll talk about your funeral service. I'm going to get a worksheet out before then. I'll probably hand it out the week before to things to begin thinking about in your funeral service, because I like that in terms of expressing your faith. Then Kathy Reese is going to come. I'm a little skeptical whether this is going to work, but she's going to talk about legal issues, and I'm becoming aware of the fact that people have a lot of questions. So, with mine, certainly with hers, we are not going to solve anything, but we'll just introduce a little bit of what kind of things happen. And if there's pain in families, I bet it comes around legal issues, not the hymn we picked. And then finally, I want to do a wrap-up week to collect some of these things and talk more about that. Now, let me start with this. I'll tell us where my funeral hall. When I talk about some of the customs we have, is this familiar to anybody? Which a funeral pall without taking out what that is? Mm-hmm. Funeral pall, I love the story when I came to Greece, when we talked about Lutheran. I did not grow up with that tradition and that symbol. But got good education. When I went to seminary, they said, this is funeral pall, this is what it's used. And it draws from two passages from the Bible. One that says, when we're baptized, we're robed in Christ, we're robed in his righteousness, and which verse you're looking at. And when we die, we are likewise robed in the resurrection. So the tradition, it's an ancient tradition, of the funeral pall is to place a white blanket that usually has a cross, maybe other symbols, but has a cross on it, and that's put over the casket. So it picks up that imagery of baptism, and Jesus' resurrection. It also was an equalizer. So no matter who you were in terms of society and wealth or position in society, everybody had that same blanket. So that's where the tradition comes from. I learned that. When I went to my first parish, they had a beautiful pall that was often used, but not every. When I went to my second call, it was not a tradition. I think we used it once or twice in the 6 years I was there. When I came here, there was a beautiful call hanging in the sacristy. So I said, I know what that is. And when I sat down with families, I'd say, do you want to use the pall? They'd look at me and go, the what? The pall. So we'd have to go through the whole story. We don't know. After about, I think I was here about 6 months, 7 months. When I sat down with the family, I said, why'd you bring that thing? We don't like that. You brought that with you. I said, I didn't bring it with me. It was here. They said, no, we never had that too. So I went and did a little search. Pastor Walker, my predecessor, the last class he confirmed on the way out, bought a funeral pall as a class gift. The interim pastor didn't like him, so didn't use it. So the first time it was used, was when I came. And there's are still a group of people associated with it. It's a powerful symbol.
Okay,
yes.
We'll carry one everywhere we go.
But we often, I think in families, we run into that and say, this is the way it's always done. When you talk to a pastor or a funeral director and say, I just want a traditional funeral, doesn't mean much. I would like a Lutheran funeral. Well, that helps me a little bit. But there's a lot of different things, and we'll get into those decisions, but I also want to talk about why we do that. I brought along, for those of you that are interested, I had to dust this book off. But if you'd like to see the quote official, this is the manual, that tells pastors how things are supposed to be done. I got this marked because time to time I have to look it up to figure out positioning of some things. But this will give the full detail. And you are welcome to read this, and you don't need to hurry it back because I don't read it often. Only when I do a class or something that I'm forced to read it do I go back and review it. But that is the way that in the United States they agreed and said this is how in the ELCA, this is the protocol for funerals. We follow half of that. I know no pastor that follows at all. Because when we get into communities, we find that different communities do things slightly differently. And pastor to family, we do things differently. I'd say what's in common to funerals at Grace is we're going to have some sort of gospel reading, scripture reading. We are going to have some sort of a sermon and prayer. Most of the time, we have music, but not all. Most of the time, we have the service here in church, but not all. And Paul, processional cross, maybe 50-50, that we do them or not. And everyone is a little different, so we'll talk about some of those customs. Obviously, this is my education. This is the foundation of what has gone on at Grace since its founding. It's a Lutheran church, and there's always been some sort of manual for that. The other thing that has formed my thinking and much of my ministry towards life is a book, Good Grief. Is this familiar to anybody?
Yeah.
Granger Westberg, and actually has a link to Grace. Granger Westberg's sister was the wife of, I forget her name, I think Pearl Oliver. Pastor Oliver served at Grace, and that Granger was there. So Granger was here preaching. I ran into the seminary. He was in the early days in the front end of what became the holistic health movement. And part of what happened, his story, what I learned about him was when he was a pastor, he got invited to take a mini sabbatical and serve at a hospital in Chicago for a summer. And while he was there, because he was filling in for the regular chaplain who was having some surgery, I believe. And while he was there, he was also exploring doing some academic work on healing, suffering. And he started it with grief. He ended up at the University of Chicago. And while he was serving a church in Bloomington, Illinois, and then he was doing his classes at the University of Chicago, he ended up concentrating on grief and grieving. And when he had taken some time off to write his thesis, he was at the University of Chicago during Lent. And they said, you're a pastor, wouldn't you like to do the midweek service in Rockefeller Chapel? Is anybody familiar with Rockefeller Chapel? One of those misleading terms. Rockefeller Chapel, the main chapel, seats a couple thousand. That's where they do graduations, beautiful concerts. And then they have a little side chapel where they did the Wednesday services. I think the side chapel, if I remember, seats 50, 100, not even as big as our sanctuary. So he started a series. And when he started preaching his service, about halfway through, they came and said, there's no room. You've got to move out into the bigger area. And by the end of Lent, classes were being canceled. Professors were showing up, and they were filling the place, the academic folk, because he was talking about life experience. I don't know who first told me, and I've heard different people attribute it to, but I think from my faith, funerals become important and worth our sitting down and talking about, because that's how we live our life. How we view our death informs how we live our life. From denial, and skating along day by day like it doesn't matter, to it's the next chapter in the next part of my life. And so some of this came up, and I'll let you talk a little bit about that. What I appreciate about this gift, and I'll share that and then pass that on up because I said you could take extras. I don't know how many hundreds of these I've gone through. Not only do people are grieving the loss of at the time of death, but other many deaths. So when they've lost jobs, when they've lost relationships, any kind of major loss, I find this book. Granger's book is helpful, and I'll just pass it around. The struggle Granger had, he battled with his publishers. These are the same books, just different covers. You know, sort of bestsellers. His battle and his struggle was, he said the sermon series was fine because that was five. But there's really 10 stages of grief. And he said, it doesn't happen that way. It's not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, 10. So if I've handed you this book, one of the things I've said is, read the chapter that expresses your feeling now. Because it doesn't happen in this sequence. But as he said, the editor said, you got to number it and put it in there somehow. So he put it in and said, so this is the way that most people go through it. That fits about a third of the time. The other thing is we often find ourselves repeating those steps. It's not like you got to do 1 through 10 in whatever order, and then you're done. But we repeat it, and we heal. I think that informed much of my ministry and my attitude, not only towards funerals, but towards life. And began measuring, the other thing he gave birth to was the holistic health movement. And this in the 70s, 60s and 70s, was where we had the idea of stress management, if you heard that. That came out of that movement. And this was the foundation of stress management. Here, everybody grieves their losses, processes some life changes differently, used a whole bunch of other charts, and studies came out of it, but that's where stress. But really, these same 10 steps fit. Then the second thing he gave birth to, as he retired again, the holistic health movement, was he started teaching in medical schools. And we now have, number one, on the physician side, the concept of family practice came. Family practice wasn't a big thing until 70s and 80s. It didn't really take root to the 90s. The other thing he gave birth to, really his daughter gave birth to, was the parish nurse program. And the idea that we could have more and do more in parishes and faith-based communities. So he was quite an influential man in a lot of people's life. One of my privileges when I came to ministry was clergy used to do a retreat every spring and fall. And Granger had retired to our area. And used to love to just sit with him to talk about that. And when I learned from him, and he'd sit down with older clergy, they would tell the stories, and I began to realize, well, some things happen by the book. But when they sit down to talk, they say, no, this is how people behave. It was a great blessing to my life and my ministry, to how I view things, to hear them talk about the different ways that we grieve. And I've certainly seen that at Grace. No two deaths, no two funerals are alike. Even if the bulletin and the hymns and the lessons are very similar, they're never alike. So I want to give you an opportunity to begin to think about your home or others that you plan for, to give that a little bit of thought, not only for that day or that moment, if you will, but also for about how you live your life today and how that forms our faith. So that's a part of where I wanted to go with this and what I wanted to share. I'm going to order extra good grief books, so if you'd like those, take them. I don't need them. They'll just click. Dust on my shelf. But I see that I'm due to order. Usually order about 20, 25 at a time. And generally it lasts my shelf a year or two. Oh, I know a lot of people floating around. I just like this one because you can pick the chapter that applies to you at the moment, and it's helpful. Almost more like a devotion than an academic book, but it helped you reflect. All right, use the scripture. With that, let me open up to any questions you might have. You good? All right. I do want to go around, though, and ask somewhere along the line here that we cover and talk about. So what would you like to have? What would you like to add? And maybe I'll drop Wednesday's list. But maybe assume that you're here not because you have nothing else to do, or you're anti-bearer, but you got something you want to make sure we cover.
Those are the things that were brought up on at Wednesday's then?
Yes.
What, I guess, hospice ministry? Maybe what some of the questions were on that?
Very good. Hospice, anybody know what work with hospice? Okay. Not know what that is? This was somebody's concern about, they had twofold. One was, hospice care, what it is it okay, what kind of options are there? John, you had a number, how many? I was shocked to know how many hospices in our area.
About 7 or 9.
Probably work with them all, just didn't realize work with 7 or 9 different ones. Told the story that when I was in seminary, the second hospice in the United States was started. First one was in New Haven, Connecticut. The second one was in St. Louis, Missouri, where Doris was still a student at that time. So as she was finishing nursing school, so I had an interest in hanging around that hospital. Took a course offered and was offered the opportunity to be do a little coursework in the hospice as it was starting. It was primarily hostily received by community and medical. The folks who started that, pioneered that, went out there. I grew to dearly appreciate that ministry. I quickly understood it was not where I wanted to spend, where God was calling me, but what a gifted ministry they bring to families. And now the whole movement's growing. There's 9 in our area. I'm sure there's hundreds, thousands across the country. And I call it a ministry because it's an end-of-life ministry to the person who's dying, to the family and all the people around, to help them through that moment. It's a difficult time. And it is not easy. It's a calling. So I always call it a ministry. Secondly, the concern was, we got into a long discussion, which we can't hear, is to what is that saying? So the person who raised it was basically saying, am I not doing everything heroic that I should be doing? Am I letting him go, or am I actually causing the death? And for the person that raised it, has been through this a couple times and said, that's a part of the part. So it's one thing, my thing is, you can write out your end of life, power of attorney stuff. You can, I know Doris and I have had a discussion on this. We do not want this to happen. This ventilator, this circuit. We're very clear about this. We do not want this. Fortunately, our siblings get along and are all pretty intelligent. I think intellectually they understand we don't want this. But when I sit with families at that time, there is always not a problem with the head, but the heart saying, but did they really mean I should turn that machine off now? Can I really turn that? Is God going to allow me to do that? And it's a matter of heart. And so that person wants to get into that discussion a little bit. We did a little bit Wednesday. And I think it's part of, in this coursework, things for you to reflect about. We can look at that a little bit more about that ministry. I'm a proponent of hospice, I believe in that. And it also led us into a little discussion of organ donation. And I'm a proponent of that. It's become much more of a legal issue in probably the past 10 or 20 years. You can ask Kathy about that. It's become a very big legal issue now because I think people have found that hard to do. And it has divided families and friends, in that. It's a painful decision, even if everybody agrees, which is probably typical of end of life. I mean, it's a sad point, no matter what has happened, no matter the age or the circumstances, there's a sadness and a tear to that. What else do we have? Somebody once was asking about power of attorney, different things, not my expertise. I know about enough to be dangerous, so I'm grateful for Kathy to come in. issues around that. Again, I think some of that's more legal. Oh, the loan against after death, and that loss. We got into a discussion with that with one family. And then family disagreements among the family beforehand or around the funeral itself, especially if they come out of different traditions, as well as, what's the last one? Oh, before and after. So, when they go. And just the loneliness of grieving, we talked a little bit about that grief and loss. That was very real for a couple people. And I always love to, I quote this, this term, Dr. Pete Staines, he's a little bit more of a therapist in the family systems. And he points out two things. One is, it's acknowledged that, what the difficulty is when you lose someone very close to you that's part of your daily life is the disorientation of your life. My daily routine changes. And it throws me off. So the example he used, I was recently sitting with three professionals, all three widows. One had been recently widowed. And they got into a discussion of loss of life and said, the newly widowed said, I get up in the morning, I automatically do what I used to do for my spouse, and he's not there. And I'm thrown off for the next couple hours for me to get it back together. Simple little thing, but it throws me off. Because we are people, creatures of habit and routine. And when suddenly I shake that routine, and I realize why, it takes me a couple hours to get myself reoriented. The other one is, this is very emotional, so the family system stuff, I think, approaches this well. And apparently I looked shocked at the table, but I didn't hide it. But woman said, you know what really was difficult for me adjusting afterwards was people were too nice. I finally had to tell people, stop being nice. So apparently I saw the shock in that, which they all three thought was pretty funny. And their comment was, you know, people are so nice, now suddenly you don't get honest feedback. Your staff and the people you work with, they're just sort of nice. And everybody comes around and they want to be nice. And they're caring, but there's a point when you want to get on with life, and not everybody is nice to you every day, and life is not normally that way, especially in their profession, where there's a great deal of pain, and they just said, we finally just had to say to people, especially the one just said, I set my children down and said, quit being nice. That was a little shocking to me. But when I said that Wednesday, a couple of people nodded their heads. I was like, well, that's something I just never thought of. I mean, I'd like to think I'm nice to people who are grieving. I never realized that might not be helpful. So we got some people interested in that. How about adding some? What would you like to see? And I'm just going to go around the table here, just ask for something you might make sure we cover. Since he's hiding in the back, I'll start with him. What did you get for hiding in the back?
I don't know. I'm interested in the planning.
Okay.
Of like your service. My service. Whatever.
Your dad's?
Just because there's obviously 1,000 options out there. So I don't really have questions. I just want to, that's one thing that I'm looking forward to.
Okay. Michelle?
I think for Joe and I, what we're most probably interested in is this whole family dynamics because of the arrangement at Joe's parents' house. They have a sister and family that live with them, and you know, how do you do it without stepping on toes and causing a family feud? Because I think it's going to be like three siblings against one.
Oh. Okay. True. Can I say more about that now or say it? By the way, do all you know have they all met Denise and John?
No.
Everybody probably knows them. I think they're most famous for being Alistair's parents.
Yes.
But in their other life, their funeral. So maybe what I'll just turn to you now. A, what you want up here, and B, if you want to say something.
There will always be some sort of kind of breakdown and everything. The
listed as that person, it has to be a collective agreement. And I've seen it time and time again, whether it was in Chicago, when we were in Waukegan, or here locally, that when it's a group of children and there was no executor and everybody has different ideas, that's when everything slows down. We have seen in one case where we had to actually wait for a court order between a mother and a father. So, so we just have to follow what our codes are. And unfortunately, the state outlines those codes and there's nothing we can do.
It's probably the most painful thing I've heard lawyers and family members talk about. Mandy? Nothing at all. Doris?
Well, I think emphasis needs to be placed on doing your own planning before you die.
Okay.
And so I already know for my funeral, it's not going to be nothing but singing. And just like my folks, they picked out their caskets, they picked out their burial plots, they did all of that before they died. So it takes the argument out of what everybody else wants.
Sometimes.
it's the same with a power of attorney. Yeah, I've dealt enough with all of that stuff. A lot of times people don't go by the wishes of what the parent or whoever's dying. They go by what their wishes are.
So. One thing I have noticed is that when it's prepaid for, they have no other issues with what's decided.
Yeah.
It's when it's just planned that they'll
make
changes.
Oh no, this is pre-paid. Yes. Yes.
Because most funeral homes will guarantee services when it's prepaid. Mm-hmm. So when a family walks in and says, we don't have to pay whatever they picked, and they're done. So
it only happened to me a couple times as pastor, but I know funeral directors much more often where they get someone say, I want it this way. They wrote it up. Well, I don't care. This is what I want.
So are those prepaid becoming more and more popular?
We probably do more arrangements for pre-planning than we do actual.
Really?
I mean, pre-paying is probably about 50-50 between our pre-planning appointments that we make. And that's because most funeral homes will guarantee their service portion at today's cost. Because whatever insurance policy or trust policies that are open, for those funds, they gain interest and cover the increase in costs over the years. A lot of funeral homes will also include merchandise as a guarantee. I know a lot of them are starting to move away from that just because of the inflation. And then cash advance items, which is honorariums, if there's burial, grave openings, flowers, any obituary costs, you can put money aside, but usually no funeral home will guarantee.
Well, it kind of as Doris had said too, the only close funerals I've ever been with were my own parents. And my mom prepared it for my dad, and then my sister, it's like what a conversation to have when my mom's in the hospital. My sister had asked her, well, you know, not that it's an easy subject, but what would you like? You know, at your funeral, she said, well, I wrote your father's. I liked that. I liked his, so why don't we just duplicate his? Who's going to remember it? Anyway, so as you talk about your own planning, do you have it written down? Do your kids, does somebody know that? And I don't know, is that part of a will? Is that, you know, so when it comes to your own planning or something like that, it's like, yeah, I know what I've said. I know what you said, but again, is it in writing, just like a power of attorney? But your wishes are there. So it's like, you know, we already know what mom wanted. We're not going to, she said she wanted what dad had. so, but that's the, again, that's the closest I've been to it, but, again, just like a will, okay, all right, how would you, you know, what would you like with your funeral, speaking generically?
There's, no, let me finish going around, okay, William.
Well, basically the same planning, but legally, you know, have things written down. You know, who to go to that help you write this stuff down.
Kathy's gonna say, one of the things that our lawyer did when we updated it recently was he said, here, give this to each one of your children, give this to your physicians. Put this someplace where you know, like, your pastor, and included in that is a card. And he just said, here's my office, and he's in a larger practice. And they set up that you can call 24 hours a day and we can access all this stuff. We can answer it. So if you're off, going to Alaska next year, we hope. If you're off in Alaska, something's happened to your children spread out across the state, they could call the lawyer and say, here's the wishes.
Part of the key to that though is too, what Ernie and I did is we sat down with all three of our kids and laid it all out along with it. To say, they're all powers of attorney, but here's first, here's second, here's third. They have to still collaborate with each other, but we have.
Here's our thinking.
This is why.
My parents didn't want any service, but you have all our friends and one, well, we need to get together, so we just had a church service.
Of our own.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
My question is for you. So you have a list from the state of Illinois, does that change monthly, daily, or just every year you get a new list and say, oh, there are a few more things on because we have nothing else to do. We get paid, so we gotta come up with ideas for it.
It's the Illinois Disposition Act, and I think they only review them like every 10 years.
Every 10 years you get a new list?
Yeah, but every time they update the laws, we get notifications and have to relook at those. I know that's been in place since like the 1970s, so.
So they have a change right recently?
They changed other parts of the law, but the right of disposition has been the same for about the last 45 years.
I'm just curious, because I know the government does things that go, what are you doing? You guys stare at him, like, wow, did you have nothing to do today? Is that what it is today? Hey, you know what? Every has that blue tie, so, okay, let's put that in the law.
Because there's so many disputes in the family, they have to.
Yes.
I'm sure that they'll do what for their board. Decided today is a good day to write something down.
Most of the stuff in courts is that way.
You know, it's probably the family dynamics that with. Because my parents are from Latvia, they would want service in Latvia. It's something we have to be while they're still alive. So it's, we've got to, yeah, you'll have his hands full then.
So it'll probably be you and somebody translating it. And then just for good measure, we'll have the sign language first.
Well, you have
that both. Well, we
then we jump on the side of the
land. Yeah, we comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is my problem with her. She's got less problems with me. And what I don't want to impose what the state says is the absolute minimum she's got to be done. Yes, I'd like you to say a few kind words over there, but as far as that, I don't really know. I'm going to be scattered someplace else, but like a good fishing hole. but, or like in the
handle.
But I do want to party, and she knows that. So, which, by the way, you're all invited.
Ours would be. since I have been at Grace, that has not been an issue. The most churches have that policy that the church organist decides who can or cannot play that instrument. Several hundred, so I think ours is a $500,000 sitting up there. You don't want just anybody playing that. And some of it is a little turf. This is how we do things. I want to play that way. Dottie and before her, Elaine, when I came, were just the opposite. They said, no. You know, we got circumstances like that, family and others coming in, bring them. Not a problem for us. And one of the things that I've just said is Dottie and, well, Dottie now, has a wonderful sense of ministry. It's the ministry first, what's going to be done. She's, I'll do it. I'll do my best. But if someone's going to do, you know, better because of their relation to the family or their relation to the music, then that's the ministry. That's what we're about. So I've been very, very blessed by that. Or we are very blessed by that at Grace. That was not true in my first parish. So in my first parish, the organist said no and the director of music said no. It was a no. You know, if you want it, if you want something else like that, then you go across the street. And that created all kinds of issues within the church family. And so when I came here, you know, sat down, remember Daddy Elaine looked at me and I said, so do you have this policy? Why won't we do that? That would be painful for people. That'd be... on the flip side, I've not had a funeral here with them that they've been, that they didn't know the music. It's just amazing. People come up with things I never heard of. Can we do that? Sure, I'll have to look the music up. I'll be ready day after tomorrow. Okay. Glad you know what that is. I have no clue what we're talking about. But they're, you know, they're concerned musicians. I think, for example, Dottie looks for that kind of stuff, listens for that kind of stuff, and enjoys practicing. That's going to help them in this time. And if she can't, she's said no in the past. So, and just said, I can't play that. You know, I won't do that well. We've got to find somebody. And that's rarely happened, but the only time this ever happened, she said, in here, I talked to so-and-so, this friend that can do that. Great. I was around last minute. Thank you very much. Anything else you'd like to see covered? What about you, Ben?
Take care.
Get rid of that plastic bag.